Well, let us talk a little about Samadhi itself. In India, normally, if you say that, he has attained Samadhi, that means he has dead and buried. That is a normal connotation for the term. In a way, Samadhi is like that. You are dead and you are alive. Our Master Shivanandaji used to sing an English song. The lines are like this. He himself put a question and an answer. The song is like, when shall I see thee? When I ceases to be. When shall I see thee? Looking at the Lord, he is asking the question with the Lord. Lord, when can I see you? And I know when I ceases to be. That means if you die, you can live. Unfortunately, not that many of you know Tamil language. There was an incident at an ashram. The ashram teacher, the spiritual guide, the guru, has been teaching them all Upanishads and Bhagavad Gita and Yoga Sutra, all the scriptures. And it's all more or less over. So then one day he collected the entire body of students and he asked them, now having heard the truth of all the scriptures, who is ready to go to heaven? In Tamil language he said, Yaar swargathukku pogaradhukku tayar? Who is ready to go to heaven? Everybody looked at each other and said, I still haven't finished the commentary part of the Upanishad. I'm not ready. I haven't gotten by heart the entire Bhagavad Gita, so I'm not yet ready. I haven't learnt the harmonium to sing along the bhajan, so I'm not ready. Each one came forward with an excuse. So he again asked, nobody is here ready to go? One little boy who never attended the class, he was just a sort of boy who does other little things around the ashram. Used to clean the place and wash the guru's dhotis. Some odd jobs. A little handy boy. So occasionally he used to come around when the class goes and he would go away. So that fellow stood up. And the guru, yes, what's your answer? Are you going to say something? Yes, sir, if you permit me. Everybody looked at him. Who is this boy? He never attended the class. Here is a sort of servant boy. Doesn't know even the letters, how to read or write. What's he going to say? So with all humility he said, Swami, சொர்க்கத்துக்கு நான் போனால் போகலான்னு நினைக்கிறேன். He said, I think if I go, I can go. That's terrific. Yes, you are very right. You are my best student. Everybody looked at the Guru and said, what is this? He never studied Bhagavad Gita or Upanishad or anything, not even one chant. I've never heard him singing. He doesn't even know how to stand on the head. Doesn't even know the meaning of pranayama. And here he gets up and says, if I go, I can go. You know, that's a normal way of presenting. Can you do it? Well, if I could, I would do. Is it not so? We say that. So the same way, if I could go, I can go. That's what he answered. And the Guru seemed to have accepted it. So they all became curious and said, sir, what do you mean by that? Did he say the right thing? You seem to be approving it. Well, to me it sounds all right. If you have not understood him, why don't you ask him himself, yourself? So they all turned around, hey little boy, tell us exactly what you mean by that. And he said, I don't know what I can tell you people, you are all learned scholars. That's all it, but let us know what you have in mind when you say that. It's a very simple thing. I think some of the essence of all these scriptures is, if I go, I can go. That's what I meant. If the I go, I can go. Tamil naan means I. Naan pona, pogala. If the I goes away from me, mean the little egoistic I am free from the ego, I am clean now, I am pure, and at that stage I am fit to go to heaven or experience the highest knowledge, the highest truth. That was what he meant. And that's what you call Samadhi. The essence of all these teachings, all these practices, doesn't matter under what label. You be a Catholic, you be a Protestant, you be a Buddhist, Hindu, Muslim, or even you don't have any faith at all, you don't believe in any so-called organized religion, it doesn't matter. That's not the criteria. All you have to accomplish is see that you are that I. And things that follow the I, me, mine. If all that goes away, or in other words, where does the I remain? This ego. Which is the root for the ego? Where does the ego live? Is it in the pure self, spirit? And where does it survive.
Mind.
Ego is in a way the very source of mind. Just because the I, the ego is there, then the ego feels, the ego thinks, the ego wants. All developments are part of ego. So the sum total of all these things, the thinking, feeling, willing, could be put together under one term, mind. So if the mind in a way dissolves, or mind gets completely purified, then it's no more an obstruction for your experiencing the truth. The mind doesn't color the pure self. It doesn't put impediments. It becomes a pure reflector for the self to see its own true nature. That's the essence of yoga. According to Patanjali, what is the definition for yoga? Control of thought waves. Anybody knows the Sanskrit term for it? Yoga chitta vritti nirodha. Good. See, might have read that in the transcript 1,000 times. Good. See? That's what. Chitta vritti nirodham is yoga. Chittam is the sum total of mind. Vritti is the wave. Nirodham is the absence. So when the chittam is freed from the waves or disturbance or the turbulence, it becomes crystal clear. That is what you call a samadhi state, the samadhi of the mind. Attaining samadhi. The spirit doesn't have to attain samadhi. The spirit is the God in you. The Bible calls it the image of God. Can ever God get disturbed, colored, disappointed? No. So the real you as the image of God is always pure. Sasvato ayam puranaha. Bhagavad Gita says. Na jayate mriyate va kadachinnayam bhutva bhavita va nabhuyaha. It says, I am unborn, undying, I am eternal, never changing. I am always the same. So the self doesn't need samadhi. It is already in that state. But what looks for samadhi? Your mind or the chitta. And the samadhi state means it comes to a sort of tranquil state. Waveless water. Alayillada sagaram bol. A Tamil saint brings out an example of samadhi. When I attain, experience a samadhi, my mind will be like a waveless ocean. Alayillada sagaram bol. Anilam sera vilakkadu bol. The light without any soot coming in. Always eternally brilliant light. And another example he gives, Arunkal irumpun samamagi ana tarasinuniyadu bol. My mind should be like the pointer of a scale that doesn't get disturbed by a lump of clay or lump of gold. It doesn't matter where you put a lump of gold or clay, it simply gives you the weight. The needle stands straight to the zero. It doesn't say, oh, that's all gold, why not I lean towards that a little? No. It doesn't worry about it. And that's what you call balanced mind. That samatvam, equanimity, samaha means balance. Samadhi, well-balanced state. When would you want to prove yourself to have attained that balanced state? When everything goes smooth and nice, and then you are all balanced. Oh, wonderful. I am peaceful. How about if somebody comes and says, hey, you rogue, what are you doing here? He says, aha, peaceful I am. Sometimes situations arise to test us. We may think that we are in peaceful state. We have attained the tranquility. All of a sudden somebody would come and say something nasty. You should smile at it. Oh yeah, that's the way you are thinking, you are seeing. Wonderful, fine. Because freedom of thought, freedom of sight, that's the way you see me. You see me a rogue, fine, okay. The other fellow might see me a big guru, fine. Another fellow will say, I seem to be a little crazy. That's how people see you. But you, if you know who you are, if you have attained a stage of tranquility, nothing should shake you. Once in a village, a wise man was there. He was a very peaceful man. Nobody has ever seen him disturbed. So everybody said, oh, he's a peaceful man. Oh, it's hard to find a man like that. One fellow became a little jealous of the situation. Said, ah, what kind of peaceful man? You just wait and see. I'm going to make him angry. Huh, is that so? Come on, let's try. Yeah. Let's come and watch you, what you do. So he went there. He said, hey, Swami, what kind of man you are? Cheating people, posing yourself to be a big guru and getting Guru Purnima donations and birthday gifts. And everybody's car running in. Instead of doing all these things, why don't you go and do something terrible? And he was a rogue, you are this, you are that. He started using all kinds of bad words. He looked at him and smiled for everything. And he didn't say anything. Then he said, "Hey, Swami, I'm talking to you. I'm telling all this about you. Don't you want to say something?" Then he asked that man, "My dear friend, suppose I give you an apple and you say, 'I'm not ready to accept it.' What should I do? Should I throw it out? I'll take it back, is it not so? Right? You want to give somebody something and the somebody is not ready to accept it, you won't throw it out, you'll take it back, put it in your pocket and go home. So the same way, you are planning to give me something, I'm not ready to accept it. Take it back." That is what the equanimity should be tested now and then. It's easy to say, "I'm all peaceful, all peaceful." Like the Swami in the cave, living in the cave for 10 years and say, "Oh, I'm all peaceful, not even once I got angry." You heard the story? See, they exhausted all, I don't know what. That's the reason why I don't like to come late in the middle. So you heard the story of anger, no? No? Oh. Some say yes, some say no. No, okay. A Swami went into a cave, stayed there for almost 10 years. He didn't see anybody. People used to come and leave some food for him. And then when everybody goes away, he will come and take it, eat it, go. He won't see anybody. For 10 years it was like that. So after 10 years, one day he decided to come out, meet the people. So everybody came running. "Oh, Swami is out of the cave now. He is seeing everybody, giving darshan to everybody." So they all, thousands came. But they were curious. "Swami, Swami, what have you gained all these days? By sitting in the cave 10 years, what did you gain? You must have achieved something great." And he said, "Well, the immediate achievement is, I used to be very angry in those days. Even a little thing will disturb me, I'll get irritated. But in the past 10 years, no anger at all. I have conquered anger." That's a big achievement. Another fellow got up and said, "Swami, how can you remember all that happened in the past 10 years? Maybe one day, without even your knowing, you might have forgotten. You might have gotten one day angry. Can you think back a little more and see if you have gotten angry?" "No, not at all, not even once." Another fellow got, "Swami, it's really hard to believe that you remember everything that happened all these 10 years and you say, not even once you were angry." "Fool, how many times I have to tell you that?" Yeah. Now we realize that, "Swami, thank you. And there's nobody to irritate you. You're all peaceful, gentle people." Yeah. "And there's no pretty girls around, everybody is a celibate." Yeah. "When there is no food, even a little old dried bread to eat, you say, 'I'm fasting.'" Yeah. that won't say that you have really conquered the situation. He should have ample opportunities to disturb you and still stay peaceful. Then only you prove that you have achieved something.